excited to show our latest carbon unit. We've got a lot of people out there using the Z-900C Plus. That was a really successful product, still is. We'll be selling them for a long time. But for some of our customers, we wanted to redesign the product into more of a sort of a sleek, kind of tapered version, so they could, you know, they could get into welds and some of these harder to reach locations easier with a more narrower aperture. Mm-hmm. So we did that. We put some better heat sinking on, especially with some of these hot climates like, right. You know, Texas,
Houston,
oof, you know,
sweating bullets, yeah. Just in
Middle
the
East, yeah. So we did that. So it's a really nice looking analyzer. A few other things. We moved the argon to the side instead of the handle. So you rotate it out, change it here, clips in. It's nice and safe in there. It's not going to fly off. And we put the display on the rear, so when you're testing, you can actually really see it easily. So you fire this thing up. You have two choices. You can do alloys or carbon. When you do carbon, it does the alloy as well. But some users may not need a carbon test that day, so they would just choose alloy. So we'll do carbon. It fires up. And it's preset to do a pre-burn and to do several tests in a row, just like OES. Right. And we'll see them on the screen. So
I think let's test some L grade, because that's what a lot of our customers ask for,
right.
The ability to see carbon in L grade.
Yeah. Well, we just so happen to have a 316L here. Look at that.
Boom.
Look at that. See?
It's like we're prepared today.
Yeah, don't get used to it. Anyway, so let's choose some L grades. X-ray doesn't measure carbon, so you got to use a OES technology. So here we go. So this thing, we're going to set it up. It's set up for a pre-burn. All right, pull the trigger. You see the pre-burn going. It's just burning off any residual surface contamination, carbon, et cetera. And then it starts showing it'll show three or four results in a row.
Something that surprises a lot of our customers is our limited detection on carbon with our LIBS analyzer.
Yeah.
We get down to 0.008.
Yeah, or lower now, I think, yeah. So you see this thing is just, doing successive tests. On the left in the blue is the running average, and then the yellow, or whatever the color that is, beige,
magenta.
We see the actual test results. So we're almost done here. We set up to do 5 repeat tests. Most of our users do a pre-burn and 2 or 3 tests.
Right.
But but if you look at the numbers now, let's see what we got here. The average is 011, and this is a 012 standard. Mm-hmm. So that's a very good average. But pretty good really good repeatability. 084, 0084, 0082, 01. 01 again, so these things are all within 20 ppm.
And that's really important for optical emissions testing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, especially if you got an L grade up around 0.25, 0.27, you need that good repeatability to know it's below 0.03.
Right.
Let's take another shot. See if we can get even a better result in there. Good. We got to get this result in there.
Well, see, that repeatability there is what you're looking for when you're on the field and you're stressed out, you're trying to make sure you're getting a good burn on the material and you have the repeatability, you know it's a good test.
Yeah, especially because you guys are out, it's hot, you know, especially in a refinery or a pipeline, it's hot. And the last thing you want to be doing is like shooting and like, I got to shoot it again,
right.
And wondering. Because look at that. This is a 304L. So again, the blue column is the average of several tests, but if you scroll over here, see if I can do that while messing it up. I mean, that's the shot-to-shot repeatability. That's really good. That's like 017, 019, 018, 016. I mean, that's 016 again. That's within plus or minus 10 part per million.
You're not going to get that repeatability on an OES, and you're definitely not going to get that on any other LIBS.
There you go, that bump drafting the competition again.
Right? We're trying.
Yeah, geez, you're tough on these guys. OES, man. Anyway, so there you go. So that's another good result. So we've really, I think, made some great improvements with this analyzer.
Definitely. Right. You know, the other, even though it's even lighter, it's easier to bring this up. If you're going up to a water tower, if you're bringing this up scaffold or anything, this is really easy to maneuver, and you don't have to worry about a big argon tank.
Yeah.
Even though we still have a tiny argon tank, but.
Yeah. No, it's terrific. Plus, we have Lauren to ship these things for us.
Yes.
Yeah. So, yeah. All right, so let's see. Should we shoot a straight grade? What do you think?
Yeah. What do we have for straight grades available?
Oh, look at this. I just happened to find a 316. anyway, let's shoot there. Oh, let's save. So we save that result. And then it shows that'll show you the average of everything. It tells you it's a 316L on the grade ID up top there.
What I love about the new analyzer and the new LIBS analyzer is the ability to easily take documentation. So you can take a test, save a pipe or joint number, save a weld number right to the test. And then when you export that, it makes exporting that much easier.
Oh, I didn't really, that's good. That's a good point. I just started, set it up again, did the pre-burn, So this is an H grade. As you can tell, look, it's up around 045. So let's do, again, we'll run our several tests in a row. 044, 045,
there.
You expect even better repeatability at the higher carbon levels, which we're getting. So, anyway, there you go.
And even though we're running five tests, this is still very fast. I mean, this is fast. We don't have to wait for a purge or anything from a spark OES.
Yeah, that's right.
Which is very fast.
That's right. And you see, the drift correction in this, you shoot a couple of standards, it's ready to go. You're not shooting a whole bunch. Surface prep is the key. You got to grinding that sample and make it a very clean surface is really, really
just
critical.
Just like practice is the most important, surface prep is the most important.
Yeah, okay. All right. Anyway, so here we go. 056, 057. That one's a little 0486. But again, it's really, really, really good repeatability. The average comes in at 05, basically. And it's, I think it's an 051 standard. So, good results at L's, good results on straight grades. And it'll do steels, so you can do all your carbons and your steels, and it'll do all your other alloys as well. If you choose the alloy mode, you don't have to wait for the pre-burns and everything. Mm-hmm. You can just go ahead and shoot them. So it's a great new analyzer. We're looking really forward to getting this thing out and showing to people. You'll be the one out demoing it, right?
Coming to a scrapyard or a PMI facility near you.
That's right. Can't wait. All right, good. What kind of other questions do you get from customers?
Yeah, sometimes they're comparing XRF or LIBS.
Okay.
So what would you say to them if they're looking at the two different analyzers?
I would tell them, first of all, I'd say if you have to do carbon, LIBS is the only choice because X-ray won't measure it.
Right.
I would also say if unless there's a reason you don't want X-rays, if you can use X-ray, you should use it because X-ray is much easier to use, much lower level of operator training. You really don't need nearly the level of sample prep. It's just easier all around. Uh-huh. So I would say to people, if you can use X-ray, use it. But for carbon, it just doesn't measure it. So you gotta go to an optical technology like LIBS.
Gotcha. And if they only need to measure carbon?
Well, we've come out with another unit. Let's call it the sister to this unit. It's called the CSi. CSi stands for carbon silicon. So it's a smaller, so this is really lightweight. I mean, compared to OES, this thing's only four pounds or so.
Right, right.
But we have a smaller unit that's only about 3.5 pounds called the CSi, and it only measures carbon and silicon. And the reason we came out with that is because there's a lot of people with X-ray guns out there.
Right, right.
And X-ray does great on your nickel and your chromium and your manganese and all those other elements. It's really a great technology. But so you have a lot of these people that have X-ray guns, but sometimes they have to do carbon, and the X-ray doesn't do carbon. So what we say to them is, look, instead of having to buy a fully loaded carbon unit, why don't you save $10,000 or $12,000, buy a carbon only unit or carbon and silicon. Mm-hmm. So now what they do is they go out with their X-ray to shoot it. If they need carbon, they take the CSi unit and shoot it for carbon. And then we can merge the data.
So it's like a purpose-built model.
Exactly, yeah. So, then they can save some money, get their carbon measurements in, and only take on the greater degree of complexity when they're measuring carbon.
Gotcha.
So does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right.
So that'd be like a one-box application, right? You have the X-ray, and then you have the CSi unit.
Yep. If you already have an X-ray, you just get the CSi. Perfect. And if you have somebody else's X-ray, get our CSi, and we'll work with you to marry the data so you can still produce a single report.
If that other X-ray lasts long enough.
Okay, that's right. You NASCAR guys are tough. Anyway.
I see the competition, man.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. All right. Well, that's a good example of your bump drafting. Anyway. So, that's it.
So what would you say the difference between the 902 carbon analyzer would be and the 901 CSi unit?
So the main difference is the 902 CSi does about 15 or more elements in a given alloy base. So when you shoot with the 902, if you want to measure the whole alloy, like take stainless, you want to see your chrome, manganese, nickel, moly, copper, niobium, et cetera, and carbon, you want to use the 902 because it's set up for all the elements.
Okay.
But if you want to use X-ray for all those elements except carbon and silicon, then you would use the X-ray for those and you would get the 901 CSi for carbon and silicon.
Okay, gotcha.
That's the difference. Because you can just use, you know, even a really old X-ray model is going to give perfectly good results on everything except carbon and silicon.
Gotcha.
So that's the idea. All right?
Yeah, I gotcha.
All right. So there's a lot of really nice features on the new 902 carbon unit. First of all, it's if you look at the profile, right, it's much narrower, and that's really because customers need to have better access to certain kinds of welds and other testing locations. So we made the snout more tapered. So it's a little longer, but it's narrower. We put a lot better heat sinking in, especially for places like Houston in the summer, Middle East, you know, Southeast Asia, where you have some really hot, humid weather to do testing in. And then also on the argon, instead of having the argon on the handle, like the older model, it clips out from the side. So it's right there, it's easy to get, it's, you know, you can change it quickly. When you put it in, it snaps back in, so this is very safe, little container of gas. And then the battery's down on the handle, we made the battery smaller, but it's also the same battery used in our X-ray gun. So if you have both our X-ray and our LIBS, the batteries, the accessories, they're all interchangeable.
Yep.
You
don't have one application.
Exactly. You know, we made the display on the rear. So when you're looking at this thing, it's got a really nice color display that's easily visible when you're holding the unit. And then all the ports are under here with a little waterproof cover. So you've got USB, which is what we're using right now to go to the PC for the camera image. You've got AC power there. And one of the things that's new, you've got two cameras in this device. You've got the internal camera, which is what, you know, when we're looking at a sample, you can see.
That always helps for small spots when you're trying to get a specific spot to test.
Or weld.
Exactly, you can get right on there.
Yeah, and but also there's a macro camera right here. So you have this little camera icon on your display, right? And you hit that, and that's supposed to flip over to your display, and look at that, see? There's CJ's. Oh, look, there's a NASCAR driver. Anyway, there you go. So your macro camera, this is the thing that you can shoot, you know, you can use, and it's pretty good resolution, you can see things. So like I said, it'll read a QR code, it'll read a barcode for sample, you know, for sort of tracking what you've tested. Right? You push this thing again, right, and it comes back to the internal view.
Yeah.
Good deal, all right. Yeah, so one of the questions we get a lot is, you know, what kind of maintenance do I deal with on this?
Right. Right?
So what do you say to that? I know you got to just clean this window now and then, or what?
Well, yeah, there's a quartz window in there. All we have to do is undo the two bolts in there.
Right here.
Phillips head.
We take this thing off,
Take those two bolts, take a nice little Q-tip, and just wipe off the inner quartz window. And it takes about all of 30 seconds.
Yeah.
And I do that every time we change the argon out.
Okay.
You can do it every other time if you want, but it's best to do it every time.
Excellent.
And it only takes about 30 seconds to do, so it's really fast. Compared to our competitors, we just like things fast, so we get things done fast.
Drive fast, test fast, clean fast.
Exactly.
That's right. So, and you take that Q-tip, you can moisten it with like water, that's fine. Just nothing with carbon in it, like no alcohol or anything like that. So it's right behind there. You get a little tool to do that. That's a good idea. Whenever you change the argon, clean the window.
Exactly.
It only takes a few seconds, and it really assures you some good tests. I think one of the other features I guess we could mention is, let's go back to the home screen here. We put it in automated warm-up mode. All these optical technologies, they like to run in a sort of a controlled temperature regime. So as you see, when you turn the unit on from a dead start cold, it goes through this, it's actually firing the laser internally, but it's not, there's nothing coming out of here. And what it's doing that to warm up the electronics, and it's gonna get the unit up to 28 C. The unit likes to run between 28 and 40 C. And it's this thing you can run continuously, and it's really hard to get it above about 35 C. But
I love the automated warm up because I can press it, start it up, and then I can go on to my reporting while that's warming up and do other things while that's warming up, and I don't have to worry about that sitting there pulling the trigger or anything.
That's a good point. And then once it's warmed up, you hit calibrate. That's your calibration. It shoots an internal piece of stainless steel just to set its wavelength scale, and then you're ready to test. All right?
Simple as that.
All right.